Good morning. Wonderful to have all of you with us who are here in person, all those who are watching on our live stream. Welcome to worship today. I'm Jeremy Jacoby, senior pastor, sharing a message today from our series called What Gives, and we pray that will be a blessing to you. Just a reminder, as always, if you're watching on the live stream on Facebook, you can submit prayer requests at any point, really up until the time of offering, and we'll include those in our prayers, and those who are here in person with us, we'll take verbal prayers prior to that time as well. If you're a visitor, we'd love to have you fill out a visitor slip and drop it in the blue box on the way out. You can also do that with your offerings, unless you want to give online, which you're able to do. That information comes up during the time of offering as well. And as always, if you're watching online, we'd love it if you would share with your family and friends so that our worship today could be a blessing to them as well. I think that's it in terms of our announcements. Why don't we stand, prepare our hearts with our opening song.
All of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinners, wake up the saints. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming. So come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride.
Always when we gather together, we remember that it is our Heavenly Father's name placed upon us in the waters of baptism in which we begin, and we begin that day again in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, as we continue with our series, What Gives, we give thought and contemplation to all that God has done for us, but also the ways that we've often failed to respond to the way that he would. So during our time of confession, I encourage you to bring any of the sins, burdens of your heart, into the failings, any things that weigh you down this week, but also to give consideration of the times when we have not been as giving as our Heavenly Father has been. So let's take a time to confess. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we come before you seeking your forgiveness, your restoration. We failed you so often this time, during the past weeks and days, and the things that we have done and things we have failed to do. We pray, Lord, that all those sins and failures that burden us, those that we know and those of which we are unaware, that you would grant us forgiveness and peace. Especially this day, Lord, we ask that you would forgive us for the times when we have not been as generous as you have, when we have been fearful of the future, the unknowns of those things that lead us to share with those who are in need around us. We pray that you'd forgive us for our meager support of your work, particularly throughout the world in caring for all those who do not know of you. We pray, Lord, that you would forgive us, for we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. The great joy of the gospel is because of what God has done, because he has done everything necessary to rescue and to redeem us, that our sins are forgiven, that God has removed them from us. He has completely washed us clean. And it's my joy to remind you of that again this day, that you have been forgiven in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's thank him for that forgiveness with our next song.
Your love is deeper, your love is wider. Jesus, you be glorified on and on and on and on. Jesus, you be glorified on and on, on and on. Jesus, you be glorified on and on, on and on. Jesus, you be glorified.
You may be seated. First reading today is our epistle. It is from the second chapter of Corinthians. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 8, starting in verse 1. Paul writes, "We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. So in the severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy, their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And this not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God, to us. Accordingly, we urged Titus that as he had started, so he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in speech, in faith, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also. I say this not as a command, but to prove by the earnestness of others that your love also is genuine. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for his sake became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich." And our gospel reading comes from Mark chapter 12, beginning verse 41. "And Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money in the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums. And a poor widow came in and put two small copper coins, which make a penny. And he called his disciples to him and said to them, 'Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all of those who contributed in the offering box. For they all contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all that she had to live on.'" This is the word of the Lord. Please join me together in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. "I believe in one God, maker of heaven and earth, and begotten of his Father before all made, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophet. And I believe one. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen." Let's stand for our sermon song.
I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed. emerged from a ruined treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me. Oh, you are good to me. Oh, you were there in the valley of shadows. You were there in the depths of my sorrows. You're my strength, my hope for tomorrow. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting.
May be seated once again, and again, wonderful to have you with us today as we dive into this new text. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Looking today at both lessons, but in particular these words from Paul where he says, "But they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us." So as I mentioned, we are we're in the middle now, technically the absolute middle, since it's only 3 weeks long, of a sermon series called What Gives, where we're looking at Christian stewardship. And in fact, last week we looked a little bit at how I spend, and by that we expanded it beyond just what it means to what we spend financially, but to what do we dedicate our life. And recognizing that the gift of the gospel, the call of the gospel includes this fellowship in our Lord's kingdom, and now we're about our Lord's business, so that in real ways, everything we're about is about our King's business, not just about our money. It's also about our time. It's about our abilities. And then this week, we kind of focus in a little bit about our giving. And as I was thinking about this, I kind of realized we've been a few weeks now into the having all the new technology and stuff. How many of you have watched from home with the new cameras and stuff like that? Yeah, it's pretty amazing. But I realized I've been wasting a tremendous opportunity. I don't know if you noticed, I haven't done this for a long time. What have we been missing in church? Memes. That's exactly right. And now we can show them directly in the feed. So welcome to stewardship memes. The first one's actually a cartoon. It says, I gotta look this way, the tree's in the way. Ralph, I appreciate your commitment, but what I said in my sermon was, I hope you all become tithers. See, that's like Tigger from Winnie the Pooh. All right, next one is, how many of you ready for Christmas? Excited about Christmas? Any Christmas movies watched yet? Have you seen this one? I like stewardship. Stewardship's the best. All right, we have definitely more elf watchers than we did in first service. First service, everyone's like, who's that guy? Now, I'm pretty sure this one should be fine. Star Wars fans, stewardship. That's a word I've not heard in a long time. A little dangerous. Next one's a kind of political, but not really. Every pastor at that one sermon of the year, I'm once again asking you for your financial support. And then we end with one last cartoon. Hey, look, the church is still here. So someone must have continued giving right on through the summer. Except I think we could change this one, right? Instead of summer, we could put through COVID. Yeah, right? Yeah, so hooray, look, memes are back. Are you excited? Yep. They get more applause than I do. But this topic of stewardship is actually kind of one that we obviously talked about last week, recognized that it's of importance. It's part of what we understand as discipleship, but it's also a difficult one, right? Just to be transparent, even though I believe this is important, and we do it at least once a year, if not more, they're all also not necessarily my favorite because, maybe you've said it yourself, or at least not you, if not, you've heard it, right? Where people say, well, I'm not really interested in the church because all they care about is money, right? So these are can be a hard topic to tackle, but I believe that we have to, that is part of our calling, and especially when you think about right now. Part of what Paul writes today to the Corinthian churches is so similar and so important to what we're experiencing even right now, right? I was thinking about this in the midst of COVID and the effects of that, but also the economic effects, right? We've had people perhaps maybe early on in the pandemic because of the effects. Maybe they lost their job. Maybe they're underemployed, not making what they used to. Maybe for some people that got pushed down the road, and maybe now that's affecting their job and income, things like that. Maybe there's even people who are kind of looking in the future and wondering, you know, what's the financial situation going to be like, right? And so in many ways, a lot of us, if not all of us, might be a little nervous about it, right? Wondering, when is this going to end? What's going to happen? What is God going to do with all this? And so to me, what's kind of interesting is that Paul's writing in a similar situation. He's actually writing something that's taken place in the early church where the earliest churches, the first churches that were Christian, actually are living in a time of famine. Something's taken place that's caused them to be severely in need. And so now all the daughter congregations, right, that all the Gentile congregations that were planted and they're around, still many of them small and probably struggling on their own, they're the ones who have been asked to kind of step up and help the mother churches, the churches where Christianity originally came from. And it's kind of this interesting change, right? Where you're looking for the younger, the less mature to be caring for the mature, right? The churches that have been around longer. And when we think about our situation, we can, I think, find some places where that aligns as well. I don't know if you've seen the statistics, but the number of churches that have closed or struggling during COVID is pretty high. In fact, there's some estimates that say between one and two of every five churches probably won't survive COVID. It's kind of an interesting thing to think about. But as we wrestle and think about our what God has called us to do, called us to give and share, we also recognize that it is difficult for us to do so. In fact, in some ways, it's more difficult now than perhaps it was in the past. More difficult the older we get than perhaps when we're younger. What's interesting is if you take the connection to the day's gospel lesson, you look at Jesus, maybe you're familiar with his story, the disciples are standing around. Now, I've always wondered this, but I've never asked myself why Jesus and the disciples are standing around and watching what everybody puts in the offering, but Anyway, they're noticing what everybody's putting in the offering, and there's a widow there who puts in her last two coins, all that she has left. And Jesus says this amazing thing. He says of her that she has given more than what the rich people put in, because she has given out of her poverty while they have given out of their abundance, right? And there's so many things that we could do and unpack, unravel with this text. In fact, if you think about anytime you're talking about Jesus and you're talking about an illustration where he speaks of giving everything, then immediately we think of Jesus himself. That Jesus has actually given us everything, all that we have. And what he's trying to convey and have his disciples recognize is that as followers of him, of people who have graciously been included into his kingdom, that we think of these things in a different way. See, they are to know something that the rest of the world doesn't at this point, which is that Jesus' death and resurrection changes the entire accounting in this way. That while suffering want is a real world problem, that is a difficult thing, it is a temporary thing. And while God calls us to alleviate those temporary things, he calls us to a larger thing, which is to share this truth that disciples are beginning to know here, but in the early church finally have recognized, is that Jesus has died, has risen again, and has ascended so that he may reign and hold all things in his hands. And he uses as this wonderful example this widow whose trust in God is held up as an example to the disciples. She is able to say, with having nothing left, to give it away. But I got to tell you, I want to be really fair about this story, because I've always kind of struggled with it a little bit myself, and here's why. You guys might may or may not know this. There's an entire like industry out there that will raise money for churches, right? They'll do capital campaigns. Maybe you're building a building, and so you hire them, and they come in, and they do all this rah-rah stuff and help you raise money. And they can be very useful. I'm not disparaging them. But the way the story goes is there's one guy who is really famous at this, and he would come into churches, you would help him raise lots of money, and he would give him kind of his testimony. And his testimony went like this. He talked about when he was a young boy or young man, he had tried to start a couple businesses. They weren't successful. He was down to his last, all the money he had left in the world were two $20 bills in his wallet, right? And this Sunday, he wandered into church, and he listened to the message, and he heard the message of the gospel, and he responded by putting all the money he had left, those two $20 bills, in the offering plate as it went by. And then, as the story goes, God blessed him, right? He trusted God, and so God blessed him, and now he was a multimillionaire. He had all these millions of dollars. And so as he finishes the story, there's one kind of crusty gentleman in the back pew who yells out, "I dare you to do it again." But think about that for a second, right? That is actually true. There is an element to which when you have almost nothing, giving that nothing away seems easier. In fact, I'd suggest to you the more that we get, and so here in America we really struggle, is the more that we have, the harder we have to time we have giving it away. The more we become sort of accustomed to things. And I include myself in this. I was thinking of this past week. I might lose a corner off my man card when I admit this, but I actually am not really that great with automobiles, right? Like I can change my oil, can usually jump the vehicle to get it starting, can change a tire. Other than that, if it's not working, I can like bang around in the engine compartment and then maybe it'll start running or maybe it won't. That's about as far as it goes. But throughout almost all my life, my driving life, I've always had really used cars, right? And oftentimes find them breaking down on the side of the road. And so last couple vehicles I got were brand new, right? Under warranty. They just run and run and run. I'm never left stuck on the side of the road. It's like amazing. And then you get a teenage daughter who has a really old car. And then she's calling you once a week, broken down on the side of the road. And I say, how did I get back to this same place, right? But think about how ridiculous that is. You have most of the world whose transportation doesn't even come close to what we experience here, right? But once we've experienced it, once we've had it, we actually find it more difficult, oftentimes, to give and to let go. And now, coming back to what Paul said, that's why I think this is so important. Paul is talking about these churches, these new Christians, largely almost all new Christians. Some of them may have been converts from Judaism, and so they still had a background in giving and tithing, but lots of them are new believers, and they've come across this topic of stewardship, of giving, of helping those in need, and it's so contrary to what they experience in the Roman world. It's contrary to that message. In the Roman world, people were wealthy because they pleased the gods. And people who were poor and in need were because they had somehow angered them. And now Paul comes along and says this about these new Christians. He said, they gave themselves first to the Lord and then by the will of God to us. Now, this I find really fascinating because we experience literally the same thing too, right? We talk about it all the time. We ask you to support our ministry each and every week, giving your offering either here or you do it online, and we're asking you to help us, right? Do things like keep the lights on, keep electricity going here, help us with the technology, the share of the services, all those sorts of things. But then on top of it, we ask you to do something like, say, support for Cambodia that we did just last month, right? We want to support a cause that we believe is so worthy and people who are in need. And so we do these special appeals. And what Paul is commending them for is that they did both. They gave to the Lord and they helped others in need. And now this is big time confession, right? And I'm at the head of this, right? There'll be times where I'll be sitting there, we're leading a staff meeting or whatever, and we'll get some idea or someone will come to us and say, hey, should we do this appeal to help this group, right? Should we do extra for Food for Hope or something like this? And the first thing that goes through your mind is always the same, which is, well, if people give to that, then they won't give to, right? And we get afraid. And so I need the Spirit to lead me just as much as anybody else in this, right? I mean, we did it, for example, with our live stream equipment. We asked for people to donate, and we raised the money to get all this up and going in like 10 days or something. And so what Paul commends the people here in the early church for is recognizing the both nature of it. But it's the why that's the important part. As he connects it later on to their witness and testimony of Jesus Christ, what he's saying is, in such a way, you are behaving like Jesus. And I've said this time and time again during COVID. I apologize if you're getting kind of tired of hearing it, but it's so upfront in my mind during this time, right? Christianity, throughout the generations, has changed society from the inside out. It has never changed it from the outside in. What I mean is, it doesn't do so by getting political power or military power. It does it by actually challenging the culture and acting differently. The early Roman world thought of the early Christian church as crazy for acting this way, for caring for people that they had no relationship with or no connection to. I mean, think about it this way. In the Western world, there was never anything such a thing as like a hospital or an orphanage until what? Christianity came around. These nutso people called Christians who actually believed that they should love and take care of the people around them, even if they didn't know them, even if they didn't like them, that God was calling them to do this. So I don't know where you're at this moment. I told you guys this last week that we've been you know, got a new house, and we've been nesting like crazy and preparing for the Queen of England to visit. And but I'm nervous about the future too, right? We got girls who'll be going to college soon, and I think about, you know, what are we making the wisest choices with money? What should we be doing with it, right? And I know other of you who are facing much greater challenges. Lost your job, you've lost significant income, and as we look going forward, what is this going to mean for us? But it's my prayer that the testimony of Scripture reveals to us this truth, that when we hope in the giver of all good things, he never leaves us wanting. He always provides. And he is providing not only in this world, but into the next. So my prayer for us as we continue to move forward is to do what we have been doing, right? That we continue on giving to the Lord, and then giving over and above to help the Lord's people and to the people for whom he is still searching and calling. Because as the church, we are about the same work that he is. That is our hope, and that's the hope of the world. Amen. Speaking of generosity, I want to share with you this week's generosity moment. Whew, there it is. So I said a little bit about it during the message. We've spent a lot of time trying to get our live stream equipment all up and going. We, as I mentioned, we raised the money to buy it all in like 10 days, and then it took months and months to get it delivered because everybody was trying to start live stream during COVID, so it's been a while. But we have some really specific people we want to thank. We want to thank Randy Rose. He acted as our kind of a general contractor and did a lot of the work getting our sound booth remodeled. Brad Ripke also helped him in that area as well. We had our guys who were researching the equipment we need, helping install it, getting all that up and going. That's Mo Prasad, Kent Nelson, and Andrew Palazzari. We had Ann Cleave, who is learning a whole new program. Everybody wave to Ann. She's had to figure out a whole new program so that she can broadcast both here and on the live stream. And then Katie Runkle, who was organizing the whole thing and making sure that we could hear everything as well and getting it up and going. So we give thanks for their generosity, all the effort they put in so that we could worship God, not only here, share it with our family and friends, but to share it with the world. And so as God is generous in our lives, yep. We are generous in the lives of others.
Take this off, right? We have the privilege today again of welcoming some new members to our church family, so we'll have you guys come forward if you're here. The Claggett family. Claggett's here today, Terry and Rosie. Ferguson's were here in the early service, Lowell and Susan and Lois. Liz was also here in the early service, so Sandra Kemp, you out there? All right, how about the Searcy family? All right, woohoo, we got somebody. All right, Dustin, Tracy, Matthew, and Benjamin. All right, so you guys want to come up here. See, which one's Matthew? Air Matthew, okay, and Benjamin. All right. So I'll give you guys a chance to confess your faith with us, and after each question, I'll just tell you the response. Loving and Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, whoever confesses me before men will also confess before my Father in heaven. Whoever denies me before men will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace and joyfully give response to what I ask you now in the name of the Lord. Do you this day in the presence of God in this congregation acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? So answer, I do. Do you renounce the devil and all of his works and all of his ways? If so, answer, I renounce them. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, answer, yes, I do. Yes, I do. And do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God, the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church drawn from them and confessed in the small catechism to be faithful and true? If so, answer, I do. And do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully, to live according to the word of God in faith, word, and deed, to remain true to God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? If so, I do by the grace of God. Do you desire to become a member of this congregation? You? Will you support the work our gracious Lord has given this congregation with your prayers and gifts God has given you? So I will, with the help of God. Upon this, your confession of faith, I acknowledge publicly that you're a member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation. Receive the Lord's Supper with us and participate in all the blessings of salvation the Lord has given to us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Let's pray for them. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, enabling them both with the heart to believe and the mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that by your word and spirit we may continue steadfast in the one true faith and the fellowship of this congregation, as we together await the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. All right. Thanks, Circe family. Can we welcome them? All right.
Please rise as we continue with our prayers. Any prayers from those present with us, special requests? What was her name, Jonathan? Val.
For the family of Kristen, who is a co-worker, passed away from a heart embolism.
Okay. All right, let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for opportunity to gather both in person and virtually to receive your gifts, to hear of your abundant love for us. We pray that you would remind us always that you have done all that is necessary to rescue and to redeem us, and that because of that, you have called us to join you in the rescue of those around us, to reach out with them with your love, your reconciliation, your peace and forgiveness. We pray, Lord, to that end, you would guide and direct us, help us to be generous, have generous lives, sharing with those who are in need, not only in just supporting the work of our church and our community of faith, but caring for all those who are in need around us. We ask, Lord, that you would continue to guide and direct us. Even in the midst of a time when we wrestle with the future and questions in that area, Lord, we pray that you'd remind us always of your faithfulness to us and the hope that we have there. We lift up before you, Lord, those who are in need of your care and comfort. We pray on behalf of Janet, for Janet and Phil, recovering from corona, protection for Ashley, who lives with them. Prayers on behalf of Martha, who will be receiving biopsy results this week. Prayers for our nation. Those prayers come from Miriam, and prayers on behalf of Jody for all who are in pain. We ask, Lord, that you continue to be with Abby's teacher, that you be with Joy as she is dealing with new medication, be with them and their health issues as well. We pray, Lord, that you would be with Parker, and we rejoice in the gift of another year of life that you have granted to him as well. We pray, Lord, in particular comfort for the family of Val and for Claire. We ask, Lord, that you would give them comfort and peace and the knowledge that you hold all things in your hand. Lord, we ask that our care witness of them would be reflective of what we have received from you, which is unconditional love and grace. These, Lord, and the other prayers of our hearts, we lift to you, trusting in your mercy, for we ask them in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, when he'd given thanks. He gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This is the cup of the New Testament, in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sin. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated. Just a reminder, we'll hand out the elements of communion, and then we will all take them together when everyone has them.
Beautiful Lord, wonderful Savior, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord,
body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you. Take and drink, true blood of our Lord and Savior, shed for the forgiveness of all your sin. May the eating and drinking of this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen and preserve you in the true faith, life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen.
Me apart, I know you're dry.
Receive the blessing of the Lord. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Let's stand for our last song.
Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory, when I'm home where my soul belongs? Was I loved when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song? I want to live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand, recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I want to live. You are who you say you are, that grace can really change a heart. Do I live like your love is true? People pass, and even if they don't know my name, is there evidence that I've been changed? When they see me, do they see you? I want to live like that. Give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand, recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I want to live.
Awesome. Thank you so much, praise team. Great as always. You may be seated.